Laura, do you realize that we've edited this bit of old film to make it look like I'm talking to you?
Yes, it's easily to understand, but I don't think a pedestrian can do the same.
What? What's a pedestrian got to do with it? Do you understand what's going on? You're a little bit of old film, and it looks like you are listening to what I'm saying. You don't get it, do you?
No.
What do you think about all that stuff where we take the piss out of Fishguard?
I object to it.
What about where we cut up old interviews to make people look stupid?
I object to it. I don't care for the idea at all.
It's hard luck than in it, really.
Four and 20 virgins, the good ship Venus. Mary had a little quim. Not what you'd expect on the lips of pop star Cliff Richards. But the old rocker's tired of the goody two-shoes image and has decided to filth up his act by recording an album of rugby songs at Shabby Road Studios in Fishguard. Filthy Favourites on the Pants label is out today. Cliff, what is it you like about singing rugby songs?
You get a chance to be a pop singer in front of people, but also you get a chance to sing songs that have a much deeper meaning.
And yeah, songs like, I've got a 12-inch penis, but I don't use it as a rule. They don't come much deeper than that. Hey, Cliff.
Oh, I don't know.
I bet you do. I understand you warmed up for the recording by singing a few songs at the Hilletley game last Saturday.
You know, I didn't have my band, so I couldn't give people a professional performance.
Well, no disrespect, Cliff, but they hadn't come to see you anyway. Now, somebody did tell me that to get the full rugby experience, you and your manager had been helping the staff at Stradley Park to clean the toilets after the games. Is that right?
Well, we've only brushed with them a couple of times.
Oh, once would be enough for me, mate. What do you think of the way they wipe their asses on the doorknobs?
In a free country, I feel it's disgusting.
I know, but you got to laugh, haven't you? And of course, your real name's not Cliff Richards, is it? It's Brian Turd.
Yes, I'm trying to forget it.
Nobody else will. And finally, Cliff, or Brian, or whatever your name is, you think singing rugby songs is a good career move? I mean, you are 85 now. You could just take your teeth out and retire.
As long as I don't make a fool of myself, as long as I still look credible as a pop singer, then there's no reason why I shouldn't remain.
Sorry, Cliff, that's all we got time for. So, that's Filthy Favourites by Cliff Richards. Should go straight to the number two slot, if you know what I mean. BMW. Alfa Romeo. Volvo. Never mind that foreign rubbish. Why not drive a Welsh car for a change? Why not drive a Gwilym? Yes, they don't come any Welsher than the Gwilym Tidy. It's stylish, but it's safe as well. And in the likely event of an accident, your passenger is hurled out of the car for safety. It's so safe, you don't even need a seatbelt. Any other car would have had glass in that windscreen, and your passenger would have ended up looking like Anne Robinson. Get a Gwilym Tidy. It goes like a car.
Wales, the land of my fathers. So called because for many Welsh people, their father could be any one of a number of men in the local rugby team. But who are the Welsh? And why? According to the Bible, God created Wales in 6 days. And on the seventh day, he sat down for a rest. And what he sat on is Rill. That's one theory. However, according to the scientists, we're all descended from monkeys, who were themselves descended from people in Rill. Which is why in Rill, everybody knows their family tree, because they're all still living in the branches. Anyway, whoever he was, the identity of the first Welshman is a complete mystery. All we know about him for certain is he's dead.
But at the Twat Institute in Fishguard, they've been doing some research. The Twat Institute, set up by Mayor of Fishguard, Mr. Kerry Twat, to find a way of genetically modifying his legs to make him taller, is well known in the world of science for their theory that global warming is being caused by people speaking Welsh.
Shmai!
Shut up, man.
Oh, sorry.
And scientists at the Twat Institute believe that this pair of underpants, found in a cave near Uppercombe Tuch, is 10,000 years old and was worn by the very first human being to live in Wales. Oh, oh, yeah. Oh, Right now, they're running DNA tests on a 10,000-year-old stain found in the pants to find out just what sort of a bloke the first Welshman was.
I hope to bring you their results later in this programme. In the meantime, let's move on.
Coracle crazy? You need Challenge Magazine for people who are crazy about coracles. Challenge Magazine, it's the one top paddlers read.
Mainly because it's a challenge. First of all, it's a challenge for me. Secondly, it's a challenge for the coracle. And again, it's a personal challenge for me.
Challenge Magazine. Find out how coracles get wet.
It's easily to understand.
Why coracles are more popular than cars.
Yes.
And what's Geraint Pillock's greatest challenge?
Myself.
There's fashion. Health. And sex from coracle groupie Nipples Thomas, who reveals the truth about water sports in a monthly column, Up My Creek Without a Paddle. Read what top judge Herbert Dipp says about the Coracle of the Year show.
I do know what I'm talking about.
And discover the secret ingredient that makes Gobbett's coracle wax the choice of champions.
It's a challenge for me?
Yes, it's a challenge for everyone. Challenge Magazine tells you all you need to know about coracles and the men who paddle them.
It's a challenge.
Out now. Free Wellington boat with every copy.
It's impossible to talk about Welsh history for long without mentioning the past. A very wise person once said that the past is a different country. Unfortunately, he didn't say which one, so it's not much use to us. But you can't go very far in Wales without getting a sense of antiquity. Unless you've gone to Rhyl, of course, where you can't get any sense at all.
Wales is a land full of ancient ruins. Many of them thousands of years old. They're very popular with tourists, which is why dozens of brand new ancient ruins go up every week.
When it's finished, this one's going to be called Ron Davis Hall. It's a ruined stately home.
But the oldest erections in Wales are the standing stones. They probably had a religious purpose, although they're very handy to nip behind if you want a wee-wee as well.
There are loads of them, possibly because the early Welsh had a lot of prostate trouble. But more likely because they were very religious. They worshipped old pagan gods with strange names like Po and Lala and Gara, who still worshipped in Wales today. There's a statue of him in the centre of Cardiff.
And after the Druids with their thousands of standing stones came the Celtic Christians with thousands of Celtic saints, followed by the Nonconformists with thousands of chapels.
What is it about Wales that makes people want to get down on their knees? To pray, I mean. I'm not talking about Ron Davis now. Is it because Wales is a holy land? It's certainly got plenty of holes in it, and it's referred to in the Bible.
Fact. Global warming is actually happening. Fact. Every time you drive your car, you make it worse. Fact. You're a stupid, thoughtless bastard. So what's the answer? The Gwilym Envirovan's the answer. Sustainable, safe, but above all, stylish. The Gwilym Envirovan doesn't just turn corners, it turns heads as well. And on a full tank of straw, the Envirovan has a range of nearly 500 yards, so it's ideal for those journeys where it would be more sensible to walk. Save the world today. Get a Gwilym Envirovan tomorrow.
Right. Forgetting about Rhyl for the moment, and I'm not the only one who'd like to do that, it's obvious that as far as religion goes, and some people think that's a bit too far, Wales has got something. So much so that Jesus Christ himself, the man who could walk on water, then turn it into wine, although it probably didn't taste very nice after he'd just trodden in it, chose Wales as the location for his second coming. Once again, appearing in a place called Bethlehem, but this time, the one near Llandeilo. He's still doing the act with the loaves and fishes, but now he's charging £15 a head to cover administration costs, which is a lot of money for a sardine sandwich, particularly when you can see David Blaine do something really amazing for half that price. I caught up with the Son of God on the Fishguard leg of his comeback tour. Right, what should I call you then? Redeemer? Saviour? Mr. Christ?
Please.
Well, still doing the same old act then with the loaves and fishes. And perhaps, not surprisingly, the tour's not going very well, is it? You've actually got the disciples out now, in fact, trying to find an audience for the night's show, haven't you?
The responsibility will be to not on every door, identify if there are any elderly, handicapped or housebound people or those who might find extreme difficulty if...
Sorry to interrupt there, but you're deliberately targeting vulnerable people, yeah?
To ensure that people who are less firm of mind than you and I fully understand the situation, they will be encouraged to...
Sorry to interrupt again there, but the disciples are encouraging people who are a bit tough to part with large amounts of cash, yeah? What do you think about what the disciples are up to?
Well, is it decent? Is it decent? I mean, you answer me that question. Is it decent? I don't think it is.
What do you think should be done about it?
Ban it.
What would you say to Jesus ripping off old age pensioners?
Well, I wouldn't say anything. That's up to him. But as for myself, I think it's disgusting.
£15 for a cheap snack. Bit much, isn't it?
Well, certainly. We're quite disappointed.
Yeah, well, I think it's ridiculous. What do you think?
I think it's ridiculous.
Why, you said that?
Oh.
Eh?
Oh.
What?
Oh.
What do you think of Jesus and the disciples charging money for miracles?
I think they're absolutely disgusting.
Do you think you might become a Satanist now?
Yes, I do.
Earlier on, I mentioned the Druids. Now, a lot of people think they're just a bunch of tossers dressed up in bedsheets. And while that's true, there is more to them than that. I'm talking about music and poetry. The Welsh are a very musical nation, covering everything from plop music with the Manic Street Sweepers to opera with Bryn Terdville. And it's at the Welsh National Eisteddfod, held annually every year in a muddy field, that this extraordinary innate musical talent is nurtured and cherished.
Ooh. Ah!
Papa Ludwig, a keen guru on my divine wines aglow. Happy looks up, Guna Dalana, includes a bald right down. What is kid, Guna Drivnon, Visi Blank, Anna, Green me, Guna, Guna, kill you, Agina, Vigi, dear ones up.
Angela Monkey there. Just after she sang that, her voice broke. And what about the Welsh national anthem? Where did Bach, that Welshest of all composers, get the idea for such a rousing patriotic melody? Well, it came to him in his local pub, the Crab and Prostitute, here in Cumbrab, when he just popped into the gents to relieve himself. And let's not forget the poetry. People say that Wales is a land full of poets.
Certainly full of something.
Oh. And it's true that in Wales everything rhymes. Gents rhymes with sense. Rill rhymes with dump. Actually, it doesn't, does it? Just looks like one. But you get the idea. Of course, everyone's heard of Dylan Thomas, Wales's greatest living poet, who's dead. He was also a well-known alcoholic and womanizer. A womanizer, by the way, is not a liquidizer for women, just in case you were worried. Anyway, what I was trying to say is, as far as poetry goes, in Wales, everybody's a poet, even traffic wardens.
I wander lonely as a traffic warden who flits from car to car. I likes to put a ticket on and then go ha, ha, ha.
And you won't find the usual twee doggerel in the Welsh greetings card either. Listen to this. You're 9 today, what can we say? Apart from, you're adopted. We've looked after you, though we didn't want to, because your real parents copped it. The writer of that verse wasn't holding back. Here's another one. Heard that you were getting wed, and thought you should be aware, I shagged your fiancé in your bed, then ejaculated over her hair. Yes.
and there's no chance of you forgetting to wear memory helmet, because when removed, memory helmet emits a constant, very annoying sound that just won't let you forget that you've taken it off. Do you suffer from short-term memory loss? Can't even remember where you've just been? Then you need a memory helmet. Then you need a memory helmet.
Yeah, well, it's not his stepladder, so he should... Eh? Oh! Welcome back. Why do the Welsh hate the... What? What? The words on the... What a... All right. Sorry about that. As I was saying, why do the Welsh hate the... What? The word, again. What a... Sorry. Again. Right. Why do the Welsh hate the English? Well, it goes back a long way to when St. George, the patron saint of England, went out and slayed the dragon, the emblem of Wales. He killed our emblem. How would you like it if somebody stuck a sword in your emblem? Exactly. And the Welsh never forgave the English and took every opportunity to go over there and give him a good kicking.
And that's for Dale Winton. And that's for Janet Street Porter. And that is for Johnny f***ing Wilkinson.
And pretty soon the English realized that they needed Offa's Dyke, a gigantic lesbian whose job was to stop Welshmen getting into England. She was called Offa's because whenever any man came near her, she would expose her huge hairy arse and offer to sit at his face. Only one brave soul ever accepted this challenge, and for the rest of his short and unhappy life, he had a morbid fear of darkness and bushes. Actually, there are loads of reasons we don't like the English. And in the 20th century, we found another one. When they started flooding Welsh valleys and sending the water to places like Birmingham, so that people who say, "All right, mate, where are you going?" could have a wash. But it didn't wash with the Welsh. And pretty soon... Get out of it. And pretty soon, an underground organization called Dŵr, or Oen Glyndŵr, the water of Oen Glyndŵr, was set up to smuggle the stolen water back. They used anything they could. Dustbins, wheelbarrows, even coffins. Their leader was charismatic semi-professional scuba diver Herbert Dip, whose particular technique was to go to Coventry, fill his air tanks with water, then walk back to Blenheim Ice, holding his breath. The operation achieved astonishing results. Large parts of central England turned to desert. But Wales now had too much water, and the entire country was in serious danger of disappearing beneath the waves. Rill, in fact, did vanish into the sea for nearly a week, but the sea didn't like it very much, and it came back up. So Herbert Dip called off his men, and their rallying cry of soggy, soggy, soggy is no longer heard in the valleys. Another thing that's no longer heard in the valleys is the sound of people going to work. You never hear the sound of a dinosaur having a poo either, but that's probably a good thing.
Yes, not many people know that there used to be coal mines in the valleys, hundreds of them, and that thousands of men called coal miners worked in them. A career in Welsh coal mining was very highly thought of, and for the well-to-do young man of the time with a good degree from Oxford or Cambridge, it was often hard to choose between a job in the city or one down the pit. Of course, you had to choose the right pit. Some were nicer than others. But it was a great life, apart from one thing, the effect it could have on your health. Many of the men felt that their skin was getting a bit rough and that their nails didn't look very nice. Some of them thought they were getting spotty. And so they arranged for Harley Street specialists to come down to the Rhondda and set up clinics. An Iron Bevan, who had a country house in the next valley, saw all this and it gave him the idea for the National Health Service. And what a great idea it was. Free medical treatment and free false teeth and glasses. In no time at all, huge crowds of gummy, short-sighted Welsh people were stumbling round to doctors' surgeries to make the most of the best free offer ever.
I was a cub reporter in those days and actually interviewed some of the first people to wear those free false teeth and glasses. What do you think of your new glasses?
Marvellous piece of engineering.
How about you?
It's very nice.
And where are you going now?
Bristol.
Ah, see the sights. Watch out for that accordion, lorry. That's not something you see every day. He didn't see it anyway. But surprisingly, not everyone is so pleased with their glasses. Mr. Phil Thomas, you're convinced that wearing glasses is harmful. So much so that you've sent in a petition to the General Medical Council.
Yes.
What don't you like about glasses?
Haven't you read my comment?
I have, yes. Well, basically, you're saying that wearing large pieces of plastic on your face is unhygienic. But where else could you put them?
There's plenty of places to put them.
Where?
That's up to the council to find places.
What, under your armpit, around your waist or something?
Eh?
You do think they should be in front of your eyes?
Yes, you certainly. Do.
But not here?
Not here.
Thank you very much, Mr. Phil Thomas.
My biggest friend is next door here.
But will you just shut up?
If you like, I'll go over and fetch you.
Oh, off, man. But free glasses for all has also had some unexpected side effects. One of them is the breakup of families, as people have suddenly realised what their partners actually look like.
You're just too ugly.
I'm really... I don't know, I'm speechless.
And not just their partners, either. You've just seen your grandchildren clearly for the first time. What do you think of them?
I think they're absolutely disgusting.
You think they look horrible?
Yes, I do.
The free false teeth have also met with some resistance. You're refusing to wear false teeth. Why is that?
Well, I think it's too showy. And I think it's far better the old-fashioned way. It makes a lot of temptation to young youth.
Young youth? So what do you reckon you'd look like with a full set of teeth?
Disgusting.
Thank you very much. You reckon that women prefer a man with his own teeth?
Oh, definitely, definitely.
Why do you think that?
Personal experience.
I think that's what you call dentally retarded. And of course, Welsh speakers, understandably concerned that the new false teeth will fly to pieces under the strain of speaking Welsh, have asked for a new range of special bilingual false teeth to be constructed to avert unpleasant oral incidents. I spoke to Professor Noam Chomsky, who holds the chair of dentistry at Fishguard College of Technology. Professor Chomsky, what have you got there?
In this denture, we have got strain gauges, which are identical with those which we use on a bridge.
And they'll measure the impact of the Welsh language on the teeth.
That's right.
Good. But generally, the teeth and glasses were a great success.
Very nice, thank you.
And it was a more confident Welsh nation, with flashing smiles and able to see where it was going, that looked forward to the second half of the 20th century that would be filled with the white heat of technology. And nowhere was the technology whiter or heater, sorry, hotter, than on the Welsh Airborne Space Programme, which plans to get a Welshman into space before the Americans or Russians could get someone up. There was no shortage of volunteers, and the man chosen for the mission was farm labourer Dan Aberdare, whose years of experience driving tractors was thought to qualify him well for the task of flying a spaceship. And on the 1st of March 1961, Dan Aberdare, aboard his rocket, the Flying Welshman, was launched into space.
3, 2, 1, Tonio!
They were never seen again. After that, nobody in Wales really fancied going into space anymore, and they started going to Torremolinos instead. So the Welsh Airborne Space Programme was closed down, and it was left to Russian cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin, to be the first man in space 6 weeks later. There were other exciting technological developments in Wales, of course, like the experiment with driverless buses in Fishguard, and Orville and Wilbur Wrong's attempt to get Stradey Park in Llanelli to fly.
Oh, I felt it lifting a bit there.
But the next really amazing scientific development in Wales didn't happen until now, with the discovery of the identity of the very first Welshman. Yes, scientists at the Twat Institute in Fishguard have finished their DNA testing of the 10,000-year-old pant stain, and they think that the man who wore these pants looked very much like this. Familiar, isn't he? Yes, astonishingly, Geraint Pillock, the well-known victim of cruel TV shitbag Barry Welsh, is a direct descendant of the very first Welshman. Unfortunately, that long and ancient line of descent will probably end with Geraint, because he has no children. The facts of life were explained to him many times, but he kept forgetting them. So 10,000 years of Welsh history will end here. Unless somebody, preferably a woman, can encourage some sperm to leave the comfort and safety of Geraint Pullock's testicles. And I'm glad to say that two women have volunteered themselves for this noble task. They are Mrs. Probert of Doigavalchi and Sean Lloyd of the television. Naturally, Geraint has opted for Mrs. Probert. Ah, Sean Lloyd, but I'm only joking. Sean Lloyd, obviously. Oh. Geraint, great news that Sean Lloyd wants to give you a hand. Why do you think she's volunteered for this mission?
Mainly because it's a challenge. First of all, it's a challenge for me. And again, it's a personal challenge for me.
Right. So you think she's attracted by the size of the challenge then, do you? Well, she certainly knows where the monkey sleeps.
Well, I'll be very grateful of that, you know, when the time comes to go across the challenge.
Right. So you're optimistic, are you, that you and Sean will successfully mate?
Oh, very optimistic. I will do it. Talking on a long-term view, I will do it. But I'm hoping to do it this first time.
All in one? Oh, good for you, Geraint. Now, before you go off to be inserted into Sean Lloyd, can I just ask you, Geraint, as the Welshest of all Welshmen, and putting history to one side for the moment, what do you see in the future for Wales? Peace and prosperity? Or do you think, like many other parts of the world, it could become a more dangerous place?
It could be very dangerous, and yet, on the other hand, it can be all right. It all depends on the weather.
It's all down to Sean Lloyd, then. Geraint, thank you very much for talking to me, and good luck with Sean. Oh, and if she tries to touch your ass, just say no.
The Adventures of Welshman. These rugby fans have tickets to watch Wales play at the Millennium Stadium. But they are considering not going to the match. This looks like a job for Welshman. Welshman? Welshman? Come on, Welshman. The very fabric of Welsh society is under threat. Is it a pig? Is it a wheelchair? It's Welshman. Speed, Welshman. One of the devotees of the noble game has decided to go shopping with his girlfriend. But Welshman arrives in the nick of time and suggests that they all go to the pub. He offers to buy the first round. And so ensures that they will get to the ground 10 minutes after kickoff, and will in any case decide to watch the game in another pub next to the stadium. Thanks, Welshman, for making sure that these rugby fans will be too drunk to remember that Wales lost again.
Holidays can be stressful, so why not stay at home? For only £500 a week, No Holidays or Fishguard will arrange for you to stay in your own house. And for an £800 supplement, No Holidays will arrange for you to still go to work as well. Book now to avoid disappointment. Today saw the official opening of the new Fishguard to Fishguard rail link, which is expected to shorten journey times by as much as 100%. However, train operator Fishrail say that the trains will not be stopping at Fishguard. Huge crowds gathered today in Fishguard to watch the huge crowd which had gathered to watch a huge crowd gathering. There were huge crowds, said a spokesman for Fishguard Police. A local vineyard owned by Mayor of Fishguard, Mr. Kenny Twat, has produced its first batch of wine. Chateau Myself is described as a strongly flavoured grey wine with a powerful bouquet reminiscent of the farmyard. Mr. Twat said that the wine would go down well with any sort of food, but he refused to guarantee that it would stay down. Reports are just coming in of a derailment on the new Fishguard to Fishguard rail link, opened only this afternoon. Accident investigators at the scene say that safety standards had been compromised because train operator Fishrail had tried to cut corners. The derailed locomotive had in fact been trying to cut a corner to save time when the accident happened. Ass. and finery. Do you dance like a pillock? A lot of men do. But don't worry, a brand new invention means that from now on, even Fred Astaire, who's been dead for more than 200 years, could get down and boogie. It's all the brainchild of Professor Zip Fastener, an expert in trouser physics at Fishguard College of Technology, who's come up with what are quite literally dancing trousers. Professor Fastener claims that the trousers, seen here being tested for Latin American rhythms, can make even the biggest Grebo look like Jean Kelly, whoever she is. Whatever next. The end of this news desk, actually. Good night.
Hello? A couple of years ago, I had all my teeth out. And I woke up after the general anaesthetic, and I could feel something in my mouth. It was a pubic hair. And the dentist was looking very shifty. Then I noticed that my face was covered in spunk. And I thought, no wonder the dentist looks embarrassed, man. While I was asleep, I've sucked myself off. It wasn't until I got home that I realized it wasn't one of my pubic hairs. Makes you wonder what they teach him at dental college, isn't it? Good night.
Hello. There's great excitement here in Fishguard today as huge crowds gather to watch the official opening of Fishguard Tourist Pipeline, which it's hoped will suck up to 500 million tourists a year into West Wales. The pipeline is the brainchild of Mayor of Fishguard, Mr. Kenny Twat's son, Rasputin Twat, who noticed how easy it was to suck his Power Rangers up a Hoover pipe. That principle have now been applied on a much larger scale to the tourist pipeline, built by local volunteer groups such as the Welsh Language Homosexual Society. Tourism is an important part of the local economy, and local councillors decided to take action when figures showed that minus 27 tourists had visited Fishguard in the last 3 years. That's less than no tourists at all, which is impossible, but it happened anyway. Research showed that the main problem was the extremely poor transport links in the area. The main form of transport is still shoes, and many of the shoes are old-fashioned lace-ups, although elastic-sided boots have been introduced on some routes. In winter, getting about is virtually impossible, with only 3 Wellingtons in the whole of West Wales. But all that's about to change. I spoke to Annika Rice, who's here to perform oral say. Sorry, perform the official opening ceremony. Annika, nice to see you not wearing a jumpsuit.
No, it's people say, gosh, have you got any other clothes apart from jumpsuits? But just a bit of a change.
Yeah. What do you think of the pipeline?
So effective. It's quick, it's safe, and it's a very good service for here because it's obviously more expensive than the traditional ferry route, but then you're cutting down on time a lot because, apart from anything else, it's a very exciting way of travelling.
Yeah, yeah. Annika, I don't suppose there's any chance of a... No, she's buggered off, Glenvale that plaque. Never mind. Didn't fancy it anyway. Tart. And Mayor of Fishguard, Mr. Kenny Twat, activates the pipeline. And here are the first pipeline passengers arriving at the emergency hospital set up to cope with the tragedy.
Obviously, any new technology will have teething troubles. And Mayor of Fishguard, Mr. Kenny Twatt, said that he hoped the survivors would enjoy what will probably be quite a long stay in Fishguard. In hospital. He added on a triumphant note that local hotels were now fully booked with relatives of the dead and injured. This is Hugh Pugh in Fishguard.
There were angry scenes again last night outside the house of a local woman who posed for pornographic magazine Top Wank with her clothes on. The protesters, many of them respected local perverts, daubed graffiti on the side of her house in protest at not seeing her firm young breasts and ripe bosoms and great wibbly wobbly good. I asked Tanya Bum if she'd expected such a strong reaction when she posed for the centrefold wearing Wellingtons on a Mac. Tanya Bum, did you expect such a strong reaction when you posed for the centrefold wearing Wellingtons on a Mac?
No, I was prepared for gossip. I was quite prepared for it, but I wasn't prepared for the writing outside the house. That is disgusting, you know. There's no need for that at all.
Yeah, but you can understand, can't you? People were very disappointed. They paid good money. They expected to see your box.
Oh, you think it's ridiculous?
And every Top Wank subscriber that I spoke to said exactly the same, except they used different words.
It's disgraceful. It makes you evil.
In a free country, I feel it's disgusting.
This bitch must come to an end.
Yes, Fishguard people are proud of the fact that they like to toss themselves off while looking at naked bodies. But if Tanya Bum won't get a kit off, there's plenty of others who will. What would you say if you're asked to pose naked for a magazine?
Well, I could say yes, wouldn't I?
Told you. What do you think of women who pose for porno magazines fully clothed?
I think they're absolutely disgusting.
Do you ever pose naked?
Yes, I do.
That's one. Perhaps that's one magazine to avoid. This is Hugh Pugh, naked under my clothes, in Fishguard.
Hello, I'm Shadwell the poet. I know what you're saying. Why isn't he dead? All the best poets are dead. Well, if it's any consolation, quite a lot of people who've enjoyed my poems in the past are dead now. And I don't feel very well myself, as a matter of fact. In fact, this week my poem is about the doctors, because that's where I went. In I went to the doctors, and the first thing that Dr. Cavallino said to me was, Shadwell, do you want to be treated privately? And I said, no. So he examined me in the waiting room. I suppose that's why they call it the community health centre, really. But the other patients were very helpful. I suppose if they're ill, they must know something about medicine. Mr. Pugh thought I'd got bubonic plague, and he kept trying to pour boiling water on my anorak. Mr. Gosainen said that he thought I'd got an inferiority complex, but it don't matter because I'm inferior. Then Dr. Cavallino got very serious, and he said, all right, Shadwell, I want you to undress down to your underpants, and it all went very quiet. The only sound was me undoing the safety pins on my cardigan. And then there I was in my pants, and Mr. Gwili said, Shadwell, I think we've seen his pants before, haven't we? And I said, yes, Mr. Gwili, they used to be yours. My mum bought them off you last winter. They're very good pants, wholemeal pants, lots of roughage in them, aren't they? Anyway, then Dr. Cavallino started asking a lot of very serious questions. He said, Shadwell, why aren't your legs moving? Because I'm sitting down. All right, he said, don't get cheeky with me. I'm going to ask you a very serious question now. Shadwell, have you ever thought about taking your own life? No? Well, I think you should. And then he said, well, Shadwell, I'm not going to give you a physical examination because, well, you might have something catching, but is there anything that you want to tell me about before you go? And I said, well, yes, there is one thing. It's, I keep hearing these voices. Voices, yes. What sort of things do they say, Shadwell? Oh, things like, Shadwell, have you made your bed? And Shadwell, where's that loaf I sent you out for? I see, and tell me, Shadwell, are there other people about when you hear these voices? Yes. Shadwell, what you've got is incurable. You're stupid. Get out. So I wrote this poem on the way home. Hickory dickory doctor, I don't feel very well. Well, an apple a day will keep me away. So why don't you ask a greengrocer for a second opinion?
Hello. If you mentioned sexual equipment to any woman in Fishguard, the chances are she'd think of men's winkies. Chances are she'd be thinking of men's winkies anyway. But that's all changing. I'm standing in Cleo Lane. And just over there is Fishguard's very first sex shop, Rimbashers. Mr. Rimbasher, what sort of people have been coming here? I don't mean that in a dirty way.
All types of people. Intelligent, educated people. Some that aren't so intelligent.
Stupid people.
They've asked us a few questions about the products because obviously this is all new to them. You know, a lot of them have never seen any of this merchandise before. You know, so there are bound to be a lot of curiosity, a lot of questions, which you have to expect with this type of shop.
Yes, one man with a lot of questions is Wilf Nostril of Cod Row. Thanks to one of Mr. Rimbasher's sex aids, his house nearly burnt down. Mr. Nostril, tell us what happened to you last night.
Well, she was out, outside.
Who was? Oh, Mrs. James, who you were having an affair with. Yeah, yeah, go on.
Of course, I bring her in, give her a tidbit, and she stays the night. This is an understanding. You know, Mrs. James knows this.
Right.
Anyway, she stayed, and she always sleeps on the end of the bed.
All right.
Well, next thing I know, I was waking with a sort of stamping on the face.
Stamping?
Well, you can imagine, I mean, waking up in the middle of the night, something stamping on your face.
No, no, I can't, actually. Anyway, go on.
When I came to, there was a smell of smoke, and I was choking, and there was smoke everywhere, and it was just a blaze. A sort of hazy blaze, you know what I mean, through the smoke.
Which was coming from Mrs. James. She'd been using a vibrator while you were asleep and had set fire to her pubic hair. What happened next?
Got out of bed, opened the window.
Yeah.
Dropped her outside on the top floor.
You chucked Mrs. James out of the window? I suppose you had to, really, or the whole place would have gone up, wouldn't it? So basically what you're saying is that Mrs. James has got two broken legs and a scorched beaver because she was using a vibrator. And a bushfire isn't the only thing that these sex toys have started. A servant at Fishguard Castle actually plugged her vibrator into the mains. And instead of coming, she went. With a bang. And these old ladies have walked all the way from Goobert-on-Sea to buy some erotic underwear.
Oh, quick, Mrs. Bowen is getting all the crutchless knickers.
And this couple are now homeless after a bout of frenzied lovemaking inspired by reading A Beginner's Course in Intercourse shook their caravan to pieces. Suddenly, everyone's gone sex mad. Harry Gobb, you're a milkman. How many times a week are you copulating with your customers now?
About 400, maybe more.
400? What about hand jobs? How many of those have you had today?
4 times in an hour by a policewoman.
The long arm of the law. Fishguard Council is so concerned at the effect all this sex is going to have on the birth rate that they're carrying out pregnancy tests on the urine of every woman in Fishguard. Even local celebrity Geraint Pillock is a customer of the sex shop. Geraint, you were in Rimbashes this morning buying a load of bondage gear. Why?
Mainly because it's a challenge. First of all, it's a challenge for me. Secondly, it's a challenge for the coracle.
Bloody hell, Geraint, I knew you liked the coracle, but I didn't realise it was a sex thing.
It has been done before.
Oh, I know, but it's still disgusting, though, isn't it? No, let's stop this. Stop the camera. News that Mr. Rimbasher's sexual equipment has entered the lives of everyone in Fishguard. And one or two objects have entered more than just their lives, if you know what I mean. Mr. Rimbasher, it seems that the old way of doing things, you know, the cucumber up the arse, the bowl of fresh fruit up the fanny, that's all in the past now. Don't you think that's rather sad?
I don't say sad. People or publicity companies, newspapers have been pushing the permissive society for a long time, which I don't think really exists.
Oh, yes, it does. There's a branch in Haverford West. Sorry. Back to what you were saying. I mean, basically, your customers aren't complaining, are they?
They are quite happy with everything we have in here. have no complaints at all.
Fair enough. One last thing. I couldn't help noticing that you're selling posters of David Blunkett in the nude. Why is that?
I think it's needed.
Right. Thanks very much, Mr. Rimbasher. Oh, sorry. This is Hugh Pugh in Fishguard. Fishguard. Get up. Leave me alone, you cock.
Hello? Oh, no, that scene in The Godfather, where he wakes up in bed and finds a horse's head laying next to him. That must happen to Prince Charles every morning when he's... Yeah, when he's sleeping with Camilla Parker Bowles. I got nothing against Prince Charles. Apart from the fact I don't like him. Oh, one day he'll be king. Unlike his brother Edward, who'll only ever be a queen, let's say. Well, they say you shouldn't criticise royalty because they can't answer back. Well, if he took the bloody silver spoon out of his mouth, perhaps he'd be able to speak up. That's right. Why do I need so many servants? 85 servants he got, man. I read in the paper he's got a servant to squeeze his toothpaste for him. And when he broke his arm, he even had a servant to hold his knob for him when he was having a pee. Should I say the royal we there? I don't know. Is it? I wouldn't be surprised if he hadn't got a servant to shag Camilla Parker Bowles for him. Mind you, if I were Prince Charles, I think I'd have a servant who shagged Camilla Parker. I wouldn't want to be one of his servants. I tell you, not only are they underpaid, but half of them are gay boys jumping on each other, man. I tell you, he might be the Prince of Wales, but I'd be buggered if I'd work for him. Good night. Right, you bastard, I bloody well am. I know what to do, man. Shut myself now, man.
Hello! News that flamboyant pop singer Elton John is to play a concert at the odious theatre Fishguard has provoked a furious reaction from local people who can't stand the little four-eyed git. Within half an hour of the posters going up, every piano within a 10-mile radius of Fishguard had been smashed to pieces in the hope that if he doesn't have an instrument to play, he'll cancel the concert. Unless, of course, Mr. John is planning a performance on the pink oboe. Thousands of homosexuals, many of whom camped all night outside a baker's shop in Fishguard, went home disappointed today when they discovered that the advertisement in the window for hot cross bums was a printing error. The owner of Baker's Baker's Shop, Master Baker Stanley Baker, is well known locally for his moist baps. There were huge crowds at Fishguard Town Hall today to see Constable Dim Thomas of Fishguard Police win the Welsh Police Truncheon of the Year Award with a magnificent truncheon nearly 6 feet long.
Put it down.
The award was presented by Mayor of Fishguard, Mr. Kerry Twatt, who said that although the truncheon was basically just a tool that Constable Thomas sometimes took out in the line of duty, he was delighted that he pulled it off and that he came first. A newspaper article stating that Fishguard Council is taking 10 ants to court for not paying their rent was a printing error, which should have read tenants, not 10 ants, said a spokesman for Fishguard Council. I did wonder. Local Satanists who dialed 666 instead of 999 yesterday evening were delighted when 20 minutes later they received a visit from the devil.
spokesman for the Satanists said that he was glad that in future they'd be able to summon the devil without sacrificing any virgins, which are in short supply in Fishguard. And finally, today is the 100th anniversary of the first trumpet fanfare in Wales, which was blown at Fishguard Town Hall as a mark of respect during an official visit by Lord Justice Sausage, the Master of the Rolls. The historic event was captured on film.
Coming now. Wait, 1, 2, 3. Oh. Ah, it's for a Spectman. Sorry. Is it? No. Now it. Oh, come on. Wait, oh. Oh, right. Wait a minute. Ah, oh, you got something. Got something in it. Okay, do it again.
Ah, well, it was their first time. And here's an interesting historical fact. Up until then, musicians were expected to play their instruments for nothing. But those two blokes were paid, which makes Fishguard the home of the first professional blowjob in Wales. Good night.
Hello, Shadwell here. I thought I'd do a poem about animals this week, so I went to the zoo and walked up to the man and said, "Where's all the animals then?" And he said, "I don't know, this is Halford's." So I bought a puncture repair outfit in case I ever get a bike. But then when I got to the real zoo, I'd spent all my money. But just then, as luck would have it, a big dog came by and bit me quite badly. Yes, and its owner gave me £5 not to tell the police. So in I went, and I went up, and I wanted to know, what's the most interesting animal to look at? And the man said, "Oh, well, I should have a look over by there. That one's extinct." So I had a look, but I couldn't see very much. But I did see an Ethiopian quagga woodlouse in the next cage, and that was quite interesting because the only thing that quagga woodlice ever eat is quagga woodlice. So you don't see very of those about, do you? And then I saw Gary Price. He was in trouble for putting a hummingbird in his mouth. It wasn't very nice for the hummingbird because Gary'd just eaten a chocolate biscuit. He certainly wasn't humming when Gary spat him out at lunchtime. Gary don't like animals very much, but I do. I used to have a pet wasp. He used to fly around going, "Shh." Yes, used to keep me entertained for hours, that did. I had a terrapin, a little terrapin called Didn't have a tank or anything. Hot water bottle he lived in. Dead he is now, though. The hard water made him go all furry, you know. Oh, I still got a little dog, though. A nice little Hinelli terrier called Pedwar. He's a bit wild when we had him, but Uncle Pob house-trained him with a big stick, and now he's so tame, he never moves at all. Anyway, back at the zoo, I thought, well, better have a look at the monkeys, because after all, they are descended from us. So they popped along to the monkey house. Not much of a house, really. Didn't have curtains or anything nice like that. The monkeys were in. So I was standing there looking at them, and then after a while, one of the monkeys started looking at me. And then he said something to the other monkeys, and they all started looking at me. And then they came over to where I was standing, and the chief monkey put his paw out and put something in my hand. And I looked down, and there was 10 pence. Mom says I'll have to write a thank you letter.
Hello? The one good thing about having Parkinson's disease is you don't need an electric toothbrush. It's also quite handy when you're having a wank. Got to laugh, and you got to laugh, man. Not too much, or I'll find I've weed myself. Went into hospital the other day, slipped on some semen on the floor of the bathroom. what the sailors were doing on the floor of the bathroom. I don't know. But in I went, and whenever a new patient comes into the geriatric ward, all the old men give him 3 cheers. Hip, hip, replacement. And it was nice to be looked after. Matron come up to me one morning and she said, I'm a bit worried about you, mister. You haven't been to the toilet today. I said, yes, I have. You just haven't found it yet. Oh. But you do see some terrible things. The bloke in the next bed to me, the doctor said to him, I got some good news and some bad news. The good news is that when you leave this hospital, you'll have a penis that touches the floor. The bad news is that it'll be because we've cut your legs off. I got to laugh anyway. Good night. Excuse me.
Hello. Local people are being asked to keep out of Fishguard Fields as an experiment is in progress to see if a sign saying keep out, experiment in progress, will keep people out. A scientist at Fishguard College of Technology said that the experiment was making good progress and the number of people being kept out by the keep out sign was a good sign that people could be kept out by keep out signs. He warned people to keep out. Fishguard police, backed up by police helicopters and police underwater search teams, have mounted a nationwide search of Fishguard after a police training video was stolen from a police car parked near the police station. Police issued an artist's impression of the video that's missing and appealed to anyone who found it to contact the police on free phone 111 111 111 2. Calls will be charged at £2 a minute. The Prince of Wales was in Fishguard today to open a bottle of wine. Then he opened another one. Then he opened a couple more.
You still have whites.
He was sick. Happens to the best of us. A lorry loaded with stolen bananas was stopped today by Fishguard police. The driver of the lorry escaped, but the bananas are in custody. Fishguard's Give Up Smoking Week has been abandoned on health grounds after several people stuck nicotine patches over their mouths and noses and suffocated. Concerns had also been raised by local construction firm Welsh Assemblies, who used the tar coughed up by smokers to resurface roads. A spokesman for Welsh Assemblies said that if people stopped smoking, the A487 between Valinda Varkog and Plump might never be finished. Teachers in Wales will soon be finding life in the classroom a lot easier, thanks to a new invention by Dr. Frank Einstein of Fishguard College of Technology. The specific targeting instrument for clarity of knowledge, or STICK, known as STICK, works by drawing the attention of pupils to the specific parts of a map or diagram. After a short training course, most teachers should be able to operate the device, said Dr. Einstein. He added that it could also be used as a weapon. And finally, we've had Cliff Richards giving us the hairs on a Dickie Dido, and now it's Hank Marvin's turn. Yes, Cliff may be a great singer. I'm not saying he is. He may be. But he couldn't have done it without Hank Marvin's nimble fingers running up and down his instrument. So now the former Shadows guitarist and Pontypool supporter has his own instrumental version of well-known rugby songs. And the entire family can enjoy Dinah Dinah, Charlotte the Harlot, and John Peel and his Balls of Steel without embarrassment. Good night.
The Adventures of Welshman. These gourmets are looking forward to their first experience of Welsh cuisine. But what is this? The bistro owner is telling them she has no lava bread. This looks like a job for Welshman. Welshman. Drink up, Welshman. Come on, Welshman. Hurry, Welshman. The reputation of fine Welsh cooking is on the line. Is it a scout? Is it a lawnmower? No, it's Welshman. Welshman enters a delicatessen to purchase the required lava bread. So single-minded is he in his mission that he almost forgets to pay for the goods. But the situation is quickly rectified, and before long, Welshman arrives at the restaurant with its hungry customers. He proffers the Celtic delicacy to these lovers of fine food. And emphasizes its valuable nature. Thank you, Welshman, for saving the Welsh way of life once again.
Adolf Hitler, Attila the Hun, Barry Welsh. Three of the most hated men the world has ever known. And of the three, Adolf Hitler, who many believe is responsible for World War II, is the worst. Although Barry Welsh isn't far behind. Anyway, they're all dead. Or are they? Incredible though it may seem, evidence suggests that not only is Adolf Hitler not dead, but he's alive. And living here, in this pleasant suburb of Fishguard. Impossible, but true. Look at this letter published in Monday's Fish Guardian. Sir, why hasn't that marvelous book, Mein Kampf, by Adolf Hitler, been serialized for television? Everything else has. It makes me want to invade Poland. Yours, A. Hitler. A. Hitler or the Hitler? There's only one way to find out. This is where he lives. No answer. Let's go around the back. Vintage German car. What a giveaway. There's only one other person in Wales who drives a car like that, and that's Mayor of Fishguard, Mr. Kenny Twat. And his is off the road at the moment with a dodgy clutch. I think we've got our man. Let's talk to the neighbours. Hello, Mrs. Are you aware of the fact that you live next door to Mr. Adolf Hitler, the man responsible for the deaths of more than 30 million people?
Oh, yes.
You knew that?
Yes.
Oh. All right. Any idea where he is?
No, unless they've gone to Swansea to the daughter.
Adolf Hitler's got a daughter in Swansea? Of course. Susan Hitler, who runs Herr Hitler's hairdressing salon in St. Helens Road. Oh, Hitler's a family man now, is he? When did you last see him?
Monday.
Monday? The day of the letter in the newspaper. What sort of a mood was he in?
Very quiet and very reserved. But he was enjoying himself in his own way.
That's a relief. So, what sort of a bloke is Adolf Hitler then? Does he go down the pub at all?
Yes, he enjoyed a pint. I never saw him drunk.
Ah, so he's kind of respectable now, is he? Would you say he's a good neighbour?
Yes.
All right. Well, thanks very much for talking to us. Adolf Hitler, then, who it would seem is quite a good neighbour. Although I'm not so sure the people of Poland and France would agree. This is Hugh Pugh in Fishguard, which is not a part of Germany. Or Haverford West. Good night.
Hello. Chadwell here. I went out with Sean Jenkins on Tuesday. There's a blind date, so I didn't know what she looked like. Still don't, because she didn't turn up. Anyway, when Mrs. Greeley next door heard about that, she said, Chadwell, why did they go out with my niece? You like her? Her name's Gravel. Well, you can imagine how I felt. Afraid. Because Gravel's a bit older than me and a bit bigger as well. And that night I dreamt about her. And dunno, I fainted in my sleep. Anyway, Friday come round and I thought I'd better look a bit modern now, and apparently the 60s look is coming back. Mind, I was only a little boy then, so I thought I'll wear a pair of short trousers. And Gravel turned up and she said, well, Chadwell, I feel like a bit of high rolling tonight. Let's go to the club spunkin'. spunk in the go-go. So in we went, and the first thing was Gravel wanted a drink. So I went up to the bra, and the man said, "What's it going to be then?" And I said, because there were two of us, I said, "A double, please." "Double what?" "Double beer." "No," he said, "we don't do that. What do you want to drink?" So I pointed at something, and he said, "That's an ornament." I said, "Well, what can I have for a pound?" And Gravel drank it all up. And then she said, "Come on, Shadwell, I feel like a bit of dancing. Let's bogey." Well, I wasn't quite sure what to do with the dancing, so every time a new record came on, I jumped as high as I could. But they had to stop after a little while because somebody was sick in the hood of my anorak. So I sat down, and then Gravel started doing what she calls serious drinking. And after a couple of hours of that, she started to breathe quite heavily. And she leaned over and she said, "Shadwell, you don't think I've got a moustache, do you?" So I said, "No. But I think you'd look nice if you did have one." And then she kissed me. Oh, it was like somebody driving a hovercraft over my face. One of my fillings was sucked out. And her hands were everywhere. I noticed them in somebody else's handbag.
West Wales Tortoise Impersonation Society held a recruitment drive over the weekend in the hope of attracting new members. But with a full tortoise outfit costing up to £25,000, they could only find one person willing to shell out. They used to say that one of the worst things about being in hospital was the food. But that's all changed at St.Sardines Hospital, Fishguard, where pioneering chef Lloyd Gros has put the patient's own organs on the menu. Here's Mrs. Thomas enjoying a nice grilled kidney, and she knows it's fresh because it was only removed from her this morning. With all the worries about BSE and salmonella, it's much safer for people in hospital to eat themselves. But I think I'd steer clear of the nuts. Fishguard's first Jewish pub is about to open. The bar mitzvah will cater for drinkers of all religions, but during happy hour, only those who have been circumcised will get cut-price drinks. And finally, Hollywood legend East Clintwood was in town today to receive the Freedom of Fishguard from Mayor of Fishguard, Mr. Kenny Twat. This great honour is in recognition of East Clintwood's contribution to Welsh culture, with films such as The Outlaw Josie Wales, and of course, The Good, The Bad, and The Swansea. I spoke to Mr. Clintwood after the presentation.
Mr. Clintwood, you've just been given the Freedom of Fishguard. Does this mean that you prefer Fishguard to Haverford West?
Yeah, I don't know.
Well, let me put it another way. People in Haverford West say that Fishguard has had it as a major player in world affairs. Do you think that Fishguard is on the way out?
No, I don't think it's on the way out. I just think that now they'll try to maybe modernize it a little bit.
You mean electricity and proper sanitation and all that?
I think they're going to get away from the obvious clichés.
Yeah, electric light would be a bit obvious, wouldn't it? And finally, Mr. Clintwood, do you think that you'll move to Fishguard now?
No, definitely not.
East Clintwood there, who will soon be moving to Fishguard.
I thought I'd talk about my wife. I often think about her. She's dead now. Either that or she's got a terrible hygiene problem. I was thinking about the time she went for a smear test, when I went with her for a bit of moral support. And also I was quite interested to know what made her vagina tick. I found out it was my wristwatch that I lost. Still worked. Guaranteed to a depth of 50 feet.
Hello! Fishguard Telephone Exchange, always at the cutting edge of telephone science, today unveiled a new system to remove swear words from telephone conversations. Trained speech therapist Mervyn Stutter demonstrated how it works.
Bollocks. The disgusting swear word now travels to the telephone exchange, where it's heard by Betty Chunk, who immediately activates the quick interception mechanism, or QIM. Straight away, the swear word is transferred to Words and Numbers Control, WANC, where Amerigo Vespucci, whose 20 years in the Navy make him immune to the effects of bad language, puts it into a system called Seriously Harmful Information Total Telephone Exchange Recognition, known as shitter. The swear word registers 1,010, indicating that it's very offensive, and it goes straight into a swear box, which is checked every half hour by a senior supervisor.
Ah. Knocks.
The swear box is full, so it's taken to an engineer who removes the filthy language and puts it in the bin. What a relief. You're on the phone, just remember, quim, wank, and shitter. Because it's thanks to them that we don't have to put up with rude words like... I don't want to say it, it's too disgusting. This is Hugh Pugh in Fishguard.
Hello? Odd things happen when you're asleep. I woke up yesterday morning, looked in the mirror, and I thought, bloody hell, I'm a bit old to be getting acne. It wasn't acne. I'd been sick on my pillow in the night. And the vomit had dried on my face. Yeah. Been on the piss, I had, man. Usually I drink beer, but we hadn't got any left. Oh, at least I didn't have a hangover, although my breath didn't smell very nice. Now, I don't know if it's the same with you, but I do find that if I drink 5 pints of beer, I'm up and down all night going to the lavatory. But if I drink 10 pints of beer, I sleep right through. Fair enough. Fair enough, man. In the morning, I have to swim to the edge of the bed, but... Oh, no, I can live with that. You could live with that, couldn't you? You do live with it, by the look of you. Anyhow, I got up covered in sick. Oh, I had to have a wash and brush up. And the wash was okay, but the brush up was a bit unpleasant, I have to say. Then I had a shave. Always have a shave. Don't like... beard, you see? Because beard, it's pubic hair on your face, isn't it? And if I wanted pubic hair on my face, I'd get a woman to sit on it. So I had a wash and I had a shave, and by the time I'd done all that, it's time to go to bed, wasn't it? And as I was lying there, warming my feet on the hot water bottle, I suddenly thought, I haven't got a hot water bottle. Yes, some filthy bugger had shat in the bed. It was me. Good night.
Hello. A Fishguard man who stole a hay bale was put on bail today by Fishguard magistrates. Let the punishment fit the crime, said the judge. He later gave a man who tried to hang his wife a suspended sentence. A plan to introduce one-man buses locally has been rejected after Mayor of Fishguard, Mr. Kenny Twat, pointed out that as soon as the driver got on the one-man bus, it'd be full. Old folks in Fishguard will soon be able to bite off more than they can chew, thanks to Professor Noam Chomsky of the Department of Teeth at St.Sardines Hospital. The electric teeth, which he's invented, will mean pensioners can chew their food twice as fast. Looks like fast food restaurants are about to get even faster. Local farmer Victor Manure has been refused planning permission to build a pigsty on his farm. A spokesman for Fishguard Council said the sty would be an eyesore. Her Majesty the Queen was in Fishguard today to officially close a window that was officially opened by the Prince of Wales last week.
A window, yes.
Nice though it was to have the window open, it was letting in a bit of a draft, and several people had got a stiff neck. Unfortunately, the closing ceremony was interrupted when the Mayor of Fishguard, Mr. Kenny Twat's son, Rasputin Twat, threw some fruit at Her Majesty. Who was immediately whisked to safety by members of the household catering staff.
Look out! He's got a banana! Boy, he's with the plums, man!
take off quickly a little bag of strange things.
The open window will remain open until it's closed. Good night.
Hello. How do you cope with death? Well, now, if it's someone close to you, like your own wife, what do you do? I had a wank. And I felt better after that. Talking of having a wank, I recently discovered a porn magazine I hadn't seen before. Country Life. When we got as far as page 2, man, it was disgusting. Horses, dogs, one bloke was doing something to a fish. Took it back and changed it for the one I usually get. Men of Harlech only. A bit of decent Welsh pornography. Yeah. But I kept thinking about my wife. When she was alive, the bed was always warm. She was incontinent. And there were those evenings when we'd just relax at home. I'd put my feet up. It was a bit of a struggle, but I could usually get them both in. And I remember how she loved biscuits. Loved biscuits she did. And how the crumbs would always get under my foreskin. I can't look at a hobnob anymore. So, I decided to do myself in. But it's not easy. Oh, no. Now, I'd read about people in foreign countries being stoned to death, which isn't a bad way to go if you can get hold of the marijuana. Which I couldn't. So, I threw myself off the end of the pier. The wrong end, unfortunately. Grazed my knee and got dog shit all over my trousers. And then I went home and I thought, right, sleeping pills, that'll do it. Useless, useless. I was asleep before I could take enough to kill myself. Oh, I'm still alive, but I don't know what life is all about anymore. I suppose ultimately the bottom line is a brown mark on the lavatory seat. Good night.
Hello. A baby that was scared stiff by a crocodile under the bed is being treated at St.Sardines Hospital, Fishguard. A nurse who told the baby not to be so silly and that there aren't any crocodiles under the bed was bitten by a crocodile under the bed. The official launch of the new Fishguard lifeboat was cancelled today because they couldn't get it out of the shed.
Come on, you bastard. Come on, man.
Oh, steady.
Come on, man.
Oh, nearly there.
Mayor of Fishguard, Mr. Kenny Twat, asked local sailors if they wouldn't mind getting into difficulties somewhere else for a while. Shirley Bassey was in Fishguard today to sing at a charity concert raising funds for Moggy, the organisation dedicated to saving tigers in Tiger Bay. Fans were delighted to see that the singer's looking younger than ever, although their chronic dandruff hasn't cleared up at all. The reports that drug smugglers are smuggling heroin into Fishguard under their foreskins have been dismissed as poppycock by customs officers. And finally, the Duke of Edinburgh came to Fishguard today and wished he hadn't when he got caught up in one of Judy Finnegan's farts.
My bleeding head's been blown off.
The Duke, who lost his hat in the blast, said it smelled so bad he nearly lost his lunch as well. If the Duke of Edinburgh had thrown up, I suppose that would have been the Puke of Edinburgh, wouldn't it? Good night.
Hello. Lee Shadwell.
I stayed at home this week because Mam forgot to pay the last installment on my trousers. So they repossessed them. It was quite an eventful week, really. Uncle Pob come round with a bit of news that upset my nan. He said, French people don't use toilet paper. They use a duvet instead. Well, we haven't got a duvet, so Mam hung a pillowcase next to the toilet. We had Christmas this week. I know it wasn't Christmas for anybody else, but Mam refuses to buy a calendar, so we're never quite right, is he? I always get the same present from my nan. A pair of socks. Wearing a bit thin now, mind they are. Uncle Pob give me an alarm clock. It's a very good one, because I didn't sleep at all last night. And then my mum said she wanted to give me something practical, so she gave me £5 of potatoes. Obviously, I don't believe in Father Christmas, and I wrote and told him as well. Christmas dinner, guinea pig we had. Mum says it's better than a turkey because it'd have got more legs, you see. We had a bird last year, budgerigar it was. Suppose it'll be my stick insect next year. Of course, Nan refused to eat anything until we found her false teeth. I don't know why she bothers. There's nothing the matter with her real teeth. She just says she don't want to wear them out. That's what it is. Anyway, Uncle Pob come to the rescue. He sorted things out. He gave her a food mixer. So now, of course, false teeth aren't good enough for her anymore. We'll be sitting there watching the television, and Nan will say, Shadwell, be a good boy. Pop upstairs and get my Morphy Richards, will you? I just fancy a peppermint. Back to normal meals today. I had a beef burger for tea. Not just a beef burger, obviously. I had a plate and a knife and fork. So it's a proper meal. It's about it, really. Oh, it looks like Uncle Pob is going to have to come and live with us because they're knocking his house down to build the cherry orchard. Anyway, couldn't think of a poem about my house this week, so I thought I'd do a poem about something else. Here it is. It's called Yes. No. 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 Oh, all right, then. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Hello. I was just thinking about my brother. Didn't know I had a brother, did you? Oh, yes. 5 minutes after I was born, my mother delivered a 9-pound turd. They thought we were twins. I was called Matthew, and the turd was called Mark. Because that's what he left on the sheet. Very successful with the ladies he was when he grew up. Oh, yes. Women like a total shit, don't they? And he was a great dancer. Oh, I'd slide across that dance floor. So did everybody else after he'd been on. He was so good he turned pro. Had a career in show business. Richard the Turd. Winnie the Pooh. Shitty, shitty bang bang. Not bad for someone who started at the bottom. But it all ended badly. One of his admirers started stalking him, and eventually my brother got fed up with it and punched him. It is in all the newspapers. Shit, it's fun. And after that, you see, his career was on the skids. He had to get a job as an ingredient in a kebab shop. Then one day, he disappeared. Police found him washed up on the beach at Rill. So I just come back from his funeral. It was a lovely ceremony. There was a small hitch right at the end where he wouldn't go down on the first flight. But the vicar took a brush to him and he went off. Rest in pieces. Good night.
Yeah. Right.
A forehead!
Fishguard supermodel Victoria Sponge was at the town hall today to receive top prize at the Fishguard Woman of the Year Awards, held every 6 months. Victoria, who's appeared many times on Antiques Roadshow and Scrap Heap Challenge, thanked everyone present and said she didn't deserve such a splendid award. So, breaking with tradition, they took it back and told her to fuck off. A set of traffic lights has been stolen from a road junction in Fishguard. A spokesman for Fishguard Police said some thieves will stop at nothing. A reference to a paddling poo in St.Sardines Park was a printing error, claims editor of the Fish Guardian, Rupert Murder. Hundreds of local children, expecting to spend the afternoon up to their knees in excrement, went home bitterly disappointed. Fishguard magazine What's New in Archaeology, all about what's new in archaeology, closed down today when someone pointed out that everything in archaeology is actually very old. And finally, the Welsh Language Homosexual Society's weekly cowboy evening at Fist's nightclub broke up in disarray last night after some of the society's members got out of hand.
Oh, you. Oh, no. Ow!
Girls, come on.
Girls.
No, come on.
Society spokesman Marvin Gay said he was absolutely furious about the incident and that he would give the ringleaders a good tongue lashing.
Hello, me, Shadwell. I thought I'd do a poem about school this week because, well, it is the fancy dress party. I went as a schoolboy. It's the only costume I got, really. Gary Price went as a smell. He come up to me, he said, "Oh, Shadwell, look at me, I have a smell." And he stuck his fingers up my nose. I don't really like him very much. He goes around saying things like he's mentally handicapped because he has to sit next to me. And he does things like telephone people up and congratulate them for being in front of him in the telephone directory. He's the one who's top, if you ask me. And then he taught me one of his knock-knock jokes this week. It goes like this. Knock-knock. Who's there? I am. You can tell it's one of his, can't you? Oh, well, we had a visit from the blind school dentist this week. He feels our teeth in the morning and tunes the pianos in the afternoon. He does haircuts as well, if you ask him. Before he come in, the headmaster had a few words of this. He said, "All right, boys and girls, Dentist Bowen are coming in today, and I know what the drill is. No shouting, and keep all those sweeties away where he can't hear them." So that's what they all did. But, you know, Dentist Bowen, he don't actually recognise people except by their teeth. He'll come up to you in the street and he'll say, "Hello, Shadwell." And all you can say back is, "Oh." People find him a bit difficult to talk to, really. I don't know, because of all these economic cutbacks. They couldn't give him a guide dog to start with. Guide rabbit he had to have. But the council got fed up with digging him out of rabbit holes all the time. So we've got a guide dog now, part-time. The rest of the time, you have to make do with shouting, "Where am I?" He's a nice man, no, a very nice man. I remember Christmas time, he does lots of lovely festive fillings. Sage and onion, stuff like that. And then he decorates his dentist's chair and his drill. His drill plays jingle bells when he turns it on. So there's all these people in there laughing and smiling and singing and having their teeth out. Lovely it is, lovely. Oh, well, what else happened at school? English. It was a bit difficult. We had spelling. The teacher came at me, he said, Shadwell, how many J's in kidnapped? Well, how am I supposed to know how many there are? None. I was right. It's pure guesswork, though. And then he said, all right, Shadwell, all right. I want you to finish this spelling rule for me now. Here we go. I before E, except before... No, it's wrong. I before E, except after. Except after... Except after 4 o'clock. No, he said, Shadwell, your father would be turning in his grave if you'd ever had a father. And then... That sort of a school, really. And then to cap it all, the biology teacher said we're going to do dissection next week, so I've got to take my hamster in. Well, that's about it, really. I'll do the poem now. The school bell is ringing. Thank you very much. Oh, I've forgotten a bit.
If you're a midwife looking for an opening, then you could do a lot worse than getting a job here at the new maternity ward at St.Sardines Hospital, Fishguard, which is officially opened today by Prince Charles and Camilla Parker Bowles. It's more like a man every day. I asked some of the mothers how it all went. Sorry about that. The cameraman's blind. Right, are we? Yeah? Right, okay. You just had your first baby. Do you think you'll be a lovely mother or a horrible mother?
A lovely mother.
Well, that remains to be seen, doesn't it? When he wakes up at 3 o'clock in the morning asking for his breakfast. No, look, you'll have to speak up. I can't hear you with that sodding baby crying. Look, all right, let's start again. Right. So, what was Camilla like with all the babies then?
Talking more.
Hang on, this isn't working. I've got my bloody hand now. Right, let's start again. Okay, did Prince Charles talk to you at all?
Yeah, he asked my husband at the birth, and I said yes.
Was your husband there at the conception?
No.
All right. Do you think it's right to have sex before getting pregnant?
Yes, it was lovely.
Maniac. And is it true that Prince Charles slipped in some sick on the floor and Camilla Parker Bowles had to pick him up?
No, she didn't pick him up. She just said a few words to him.
I can imagine what they were. And you met Prince Charles as well? Did he have sick on his trousers?
Yeah.
He hadn't cleaned any of it off?
No, none at all.
Disgusting. And I heard that Camilla Parker Bowles was trying to grab the doctor's private parts.
No, she didn't hold any of them.
Ah, just talked to the mothers then, did she? What did she talk about?
Well, more about the baby, you know, very interested in children she was.
Ah! I gotta sleep on a shite now! And a broken hand! Oh, let's leave it there, I've had enough. This is Hugh Pugh, covered in poo in Fishguard. Devastation. Tragedy. Fishguard. But what caused this destruction? An earthquake? A hurricane? Or was it an act of God? No. It was, in fact, an act of Judy Finnegan, who has the digestive system of a hippopotamus and an arse like a windsock. And since last Friday, when she consumed a haddock vindaloo at the Vag Indian restaurant, her terrible farts have been causing death and destruction, both on land and at sea, depending on which way she was pointing.
Judy, what does it feel like when you let one go?
It's shattering the factory.
Yeah, shattering, all right.
But it makes you stop and listen, makes you tense for a moment or two, you know, until you realise what's happened. But...
Aye, and what's usually happened is you've blown out a street full of windows.
Oh, it was pretty terrific the one we had yesterday. It shook the whole place. There was no getting away from it. All the dogs and the kids started creaming down our way with it. It was really a vicious one.
Oh, you think it's ridiculous?
They're pretty loud then.
Oh.
Loud enough to frighten anybody. And children asleep. Well, frighten them out of their wits.
Like if it comes from the sky, you know, whoop through the street about 3:45.
Did people panic at all?
Well, not much. We walked on, you know. But we thought it came from the sky. I don't know whether it did or no.
No. Judy Finnegan. That's where it came from. Even fellow celebrity Vanessa Phelps has been affected. Vanessa. Judy came down for a threesome with you and your boyfriend and dropped a big one on the landing. How do you feel about that?
Well, mad, of course, and everything is upside down.
Caused a lot of damage, did she?
You ought to go upstairs and see upstairs. It's wicked up there.
I decided not to go upstairs with Vanessa Phelps. Doesn't look the same without her makeup on, does she? Anyway, Judy Finnegan's farts are not just knocking down people's houses. They're also raising global warming. Single-handedly, or should I say, single-arsedly, Judy Finnegan is raising the temperature by 0.5 degree every time she cracks one off. At this rate, Fishguard will soon be like Rimini in Italy, wherever that is. Which would be great for tourism, but for one thing, the smell. I mean, would you want to spend a holiday somewhere that Judy Finnegan had just dropped her guts? Bad enough for the people who are used to it, as Judy herself admits.
I think it's rather bad for people's nerves than myself. Well, so is everything else these days.
But even a cloud of stinking, rancid, smelly fart gas has a silver lining. Local celebrity Gerard Pillock is going to raise money for charity by seeing how long he can keep his head under Judy's duvet after she's let out a badger. Gerard, have you thought what it's going to be like under there?
It could be very dangerous, and yet on the other hand, it can be all right.
Whatever it is, Gerard, it's not going to be all right. Now, you're doing this to raise money for the RSPCA, the Royal Society for the Prevention of Coracle Abuse, a charity very close to your heart. But surely there are easier ways to raise money than this. I mean, why have you picked something so horrible?
Mainly because it's a challenge. First of all, it's a challenge for me.
Yeah?
And again, it's a personal challenge for me.
Nobody's arguing with that, Geraint. Good luck, mate. And good night. This is Hugh Pugh in Fishguard. Or should I say, the Windy City.
Hello. Chadwell, yeah? I was just having a look at my collection. I got the spoon, and the comb, a couple of biros. It's quite a good set, really. Anyway, this week I thought I'd talk to you about the holidays. Last year we had a fortnight in Birmingham. It was quite nice. But this year, Mam said she wanted to go somewhere that wasn't Birmingham. Obviously, it's not a new holiday that we're having. It's one that some people have had before. You know. Anyway, the whole family decided that what we'd like to do this year would be to go to Sla by the sea. And Sla is quite interesting as holiday resorts go because the sewage from most of North Wales goes into the sea just there. They got big signs up on the beach for swimmers saying, "Now wash your hands." But the problem was Pedwar, our little Llanelli terrier, because he was very unhappy last year in the kennels, and Uncle Pob said it wasn't really fair that he should have to go through all that again, so he drowned him. It was for his own good, really. Anyway, the great day come, and I'd packed my suitcase in Mam's suitcase, and I'd put on my new holiday shirt. It's very modern. Got 3 sleeves. Yes. No, I got it off a man in the market. He said they're very trendy at the moment. Everybody in Cardiff is wearing them. Anyway, there we were. We were all off, everybody cheerful and full of peas, and Uncle Denzel had promised... No, it wasn't Uncle Denzel. Uncle Pope had promised that he'd take us in his company car, and I hadn't realised until then that he's a milkman. Anyway, off we went, and it was a lovely... Lovely hot August morning, and everything went very nicely till around about November. But Uncle Pope said he thought we were going the wrong way. And Nan said, yes, yes, we should have gone by train.
We interrupt this programme to bring you a news flash. Sorry, flash. The Judy Finnegan situation has worsened dramatically in the last hour after she let out a rasper, then followed through with solid material. The jobby, which has overwhelmed most of Fishguard and is now on its way to Haverford West, was described by an eyewitness as indescribable. A nose witness said that it stank. An emergency sitting of Fishguard Council Environmental Disaster Committee, Fakedk, voted unanimously in favour of a motion to stop the movement. The chairman of the committee, Mayor of Fishguard, Mr. Kenny Twatt, said the cost to the environment was incalculable, but would probably be around £15. This is Hugh Pugh in Fishguard.
Hello. Bloke come round the other day selling insurance. He went on and on and on about how if I had an accident, the insurance company would pay up. So I said, better get your checkbook out then. As while I've been standing here listening to you, I've had an accident. In my trousers. And he said, no, oh, no, I'm sorry, I can't help you, you're not covered. I said, I bloody am. Oh. He wasn't very helpful, was he? Not like me, you see, I like to help people. I like to help old ladies across the road. I go up to them and I say, excuse me, do you want to touch my knob? And they're across that road in about half a second. A woman fainted on the pavement the other day, so I went to help. I thought, right, first thing you have to do is loosen tight clothing. So I undid my trousers. Then I tried the kiss of life. Tongues and everything, man. But it didn't seem to work, and I thought, well, perhaps the airway is blocked. And I looked down, and sure enough, my knob had somehow got lodged in her throat. So immediately, after about 5 or 6 minutes, I pulled it out and she came to. It was a very satisfying moment for both of us. Good night.
There, man. Hello! West Wales Ornithological Trust, WWAT, is concerned about a blind seagull which keeps missing its nest when laying its eggs. Mayor of Fishguard and keen birdwatcher Mr. Kenny Twatt, who's an expert on tits, had suggested providing the seagull with a very small guide dog. A spokesman for WWAT said that the problem with Mr. Twatt's idea was that it was bollocks. There were angry scenes today at the Welsh Language Homosexual Society. Following revelations in a Sunday tabloid that its chairman, Peter Satchell, is heterosexual. And they've called for his resignation from the society, Mr. Satchell, who started at the bottom and worked his way up, said, I bent over backwards to accommodate all the members, but accept that as I am now a heterosexual, my position will have to change. Mr. Satchell added that although he regretted what had happened, he had no regrets. Following poor sales figures, Boring Magazine, which is about drills and drilling, is to be relaunched as Interesting Magazine, even though that doesn't make any sense.
No trains ran from Fishguard again today because of a sign warning people to beware of trains. Train drivers have taken the advice to heart and are now too frightened to go near their trains. And finally, the top half of Prince Charles was in Fishguard today, accompanied by 3/8 of Mayor of Fishguard, Mr. Kenny Twatt. His bottom half spent the afternoon in Haverford West. Good night. Hello. Why does my big toe always make a hole in my sock? My knob don't make a hole in my pants. They both the same size. Odd, it's odd, isn't it? Yeah, here's another odd thing. Every morning, right, at 8 o'clock, my wife has a poo. I wouldn't mind, but she don't get up till 9:30. People are just very strange, and last week, right, I saw an old bloke in the kitchen at the day centre frying a pan of sick. I said to him, "What are you doing?" He said, "You can't have it cold, it'd be horrible." We had a break-in the other day. Gay burglars. Got in through the back entrance. And tidied the place up. There was a case of diarrhea there this morning. How anyone could mistake a suitcase for a lavatory is beyond me, but... Was that senile dementia for you? Hey, hey, do you know what they call it when a man is so old he can't get an erection? Penile dementia. Yeah, it's a funny old world. Here's another thing, another odd thing that my wife does. She's always licking her lips. I don't know how she does it. Must be double jointed. Good night. Did I bloody have you now? I will.
What if I ask for her?
Hello. We are interrupting this program, if you can call it that, to bring news of an accident at the Welsh cheese plant in Fishguard, which has resulted in the release of toxic cheese fumes into the surrounding area. Mayor of Fishguard, Mr. Kenny Twatt, who sits on the cheese board, said the incident happened when a tank of cottage cheese, made exclusively for homosexuals in Cardiff, was accidentally contaminated with cheesy helmets. Mr. Twatt, who's also chairman of the disaster committee, said that the cheese fumes are not dangerous, but advised people to start panicking anyway, just as a precaution. Most of Fishguard is now totally cheesed off. Good night. Hello. We've got a yellow line on the road outside the old people's home. It's not a parking restriction. It's where Matron ran over a canary. My bloody canary, man. I've always had pets, see. When I was a boy, I had a tortoise called Michel. And every winter, when it was time for Michel to hibernate, my mother would put her in a box. Odd place to put a tortoise in. But at least it was nice and warm for the And she'd get coconuts for the tits. A bra would have been more comfortable for her. We were poor, you see. And a dog,
Well-trained little dog he was. Sit, he would sit. Fetch, he would fetch. Come, well, I had to get rid of him. But I was a happy little boy, see? My parents loved me. I know there was a lot of drinking and violence and sexual depravity, and they tried to make me stop, but I liked it. We really were very poor, though. If it got cold, I'd put on a Swansea foot warmer. Do you know what that is? Swansea foot warmer? Turd in a sock. But poor as we were, the whole family loved animals. As my old dad used to say to us, a dog is not just for Christmas. You could have it cold on Boxing Day. One night. Right. I'm telling you now. There we are. It's not in you. Ah! Oh, dear. I've arrived.
Hello. Fishguard police are investigating the deaths of more than 300 turkeys. A police spokesman said that it was a puzzling case because the turkeys were all in excellent health, except they were dead. He added that they were treating the incident seriously, unlike some incidents which they had a good laugh at. Popular nursery rhyme character Humpty Dumpty returned to work today after falling off a wall at the weekend during a heavy drinking session. A remorseful Mr. Dumpty said, "I had too much to drink and I got smashed. It won't happen again." Fishguard shopkeeper Tom Foolery has been found guilty of selling aftershave that's past its smell-by date. The breach of trading standards was spotted by Mayor of Fishguard Mr. Kenny Twat's wife, Mrs. Twat, who became suspicious when her husband began to smell as if he'd shat himself all the time, instead of just occasionally. Fishguard police are looking for a one-legged man who robbed a bank, then made off on foot. Constable Tim Thomas advised people not to approach the man. He may have only one leg, but he is armed. Fishguard was celebrated today on the anniversary of the anniversary of a local man who changed the world, yet whose name means nothing to most people and something to no people at all. Yet without him, motorists would have nowhere to park on a double yellow line, and drunks would have nowhere to be sick on a Saturday night. Yes, he's the man who invented the street, Edward Street, honored in Fishguard by having Fishguard Street, Edward Street, named after him. And Fishguard made sure it was a day to remember with street parties, street theatre, and of course the ever popular street fight. Nice day out, all thanks to Edward Street. And tonight in bed, the people of Fishguard will be remembering their other famous son, John Thomas.
Hello. Work started this morning on the new Fishguard Underground Metro system. However, by lunchtime, the project had gone hugely over budget and had to be abandoned. There was a public health scare in Fishguard this week after contaminated hemorrhoid cream was sold to members of the public by mistake. Fishguard police believe the cream had been tampered with by criminals. They say that their inquiries should lead to a number of arses. Sorry, a number of arrests. And finally, the town of Fishguard got itself a fire brigade today after years of campaigning. The volunteer force of part-time firemen was soon in action. A note is passed to Mr. Tup in the post office informing him of the blaze, and he quickly alerts his brave firefighting colleagues who drop everything and rush to the scene to do battle with the conflagration. Good.
Who's that?
Ooh. Oh, boy, so quick.
Get him. Hop in, boys. Wait. Oh. They're a bit younger now.
Right, get right. What's up?
Fix him up.
Whatever is it?
Tell me. I've got it here. Water.
It was just pure bad luck that the fire went out 2 hours later.
Mayor of Fishguard, Mr. Kerry Twat, said he was relieved that Fishguard people could now set fire to their homes in complete safety.
Well-known local Scotsman Glenn Fiddick was up with the lark yesterday morning to play his bagpipes at the Fishguard Festival.
Unfortunately, somebody had told him the wrong day, and he was the only one there. I wonder who that was.
Today, however, was the day of the festival, and with the Scottish piper confined to his bed with a hangover, everybody else had a great time. And there was something for everyone, from the tallest midget contest to an exciting display of men hurting themselves.
Oh! Oh! Oh!
From the amazing world of dark, where you can actually experience nighttime during the day.
What dark?
To a display of homosexuality by the Welsh Language Homosexual Society.
And there were celebrities there too. I spotted television star Geraint Killick mingling in the crowd. Although when he realised I'd seen him, he stopped mingling and did his trousers up. I spoke to him anyway. Geraint, what do you think of this year's festival?
It could be very dangerous, and yet on the other hand, it can be all right. It all depends on the weather.
All right. But if it's a nice day, you're optimistic, are you, that everyone will have a good time?
Oh, very optimistic.
Good. By the way, as we're having a chat, do you mind if I ask you, Geraint, why is it you always say mainly because it's a challenge whenever you talk to someone?
Mainly because it's a challenge.
Oh, is that the reason? Oh, well, thanks for talking to me. Back to the festival.
And it was good to see old favourite Ned Wazzock and his lawnmower of death back again, despite the tragic loss of his brother last year in a hail of grass clippings. Ever popular Yanto Plague and his Welsh squeaking rats were a big hit too. And no festival would be complete without the astonishing Man Behind the Hedge. Topping the bill in the big tent was a performance by gifted musical family, the Twats, conducted by Rasputin Twat, following in the footsteps of their talented father, Mayor of Fishguard, Mr. Kenny Twat. The Nolans had better watch out, whoever they are.
And finally, the man who loves a challenge, Geraint Pillock, has moved to Haverford West, where he plans to lead a quiet life away from the glare of television. When asked to appear on Lookout Wales, he refused. I talked to him about why he didn't want to talk to me. Geraint, it's not going to be easy for a celebrity such as yourself to avoid the cameras. Are you optimistic about never giving any interviews?
Oh, very optimistic. I will do it. Talking on a long-term view, I will do it. But I'm hoping to do it this first time.
You're hoping not to do this interview?
Well,
All right, we'll come back to that one. Haverford West, then. Why do you want to live in Haverford West? Nobody else does.
Mainly because it's a challenge. First of all, it's a challenge for me. Secondly, it's a challenge for the Coracle. And again, it's a personal challenge for me to keep the Coracle and the tradition alive.
Well, it's certainly a challenge for the Coracle, isn't it? Because Haverford West, they're on the coast. Why didn't you move to Fishguardman on the sea?
It's a personal challenge for me to keep the Coracle and the tradition alive.
You can say that again.
Again, it's a personal challenge for me to keep the Coracle and the tradition alive.
Trials started today in Fishguard of a new way of helping blind pigs get about using a guide man. It's hoped that this simple method, based on slapping the pig with a white stick, will enable sightless pigs throughout the country to lead a nearly normal life in the muck. Cleaning up have been going on in Fishguard all day after a pigeon flew over the town this morning and shat. Good night.
Good night.
Go on.
Good night.
Do you realise that we've edited this bit of old film to make it look like I'm talking to you?
Yes, it's easily to understand, but I don't think the pedestrian
Can do the same.
What? What's the pedestrian got to do with it? Do you understand what's going on? You're a little bit of old film, and it looks like you were listening to what I'm saying. You don't get it, do you?
No.
Good.